I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. And all my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
I see. reaching, all knowing. He counts not their sum, thrown into a sea without bottom or shore. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more.
For youth and worship here at Coast Hills Community Church, where we are a Jesus-centered community creating gracious space through acts of generous love. A special welcome to anybody who is new here this morning. We want you to know that you are welcome here and we are glad that you have joined us. I have a couple of announcements for you this morning. First off, it is Communion Sunday this morning, so be sure to grab your elements, your bread and juice, whatever you may, so that you can participate with us later on in the service as we partake in communion together. Secondly, speaking of services, we're able to continue gathering in person with church at our ministry center over the summer. We're able to sing together, be with one another again, and we are so excited to continue doing so. Now, the space at our ministry center is still under a capacity limit, so we do ask that you sign up ahead of time to ensure that you've got your spot, but the capacity has increased, which we are thankful for. Let me continue in the service by speaking over a call to worship for you, and then we'll listen to a song together, sing along if you're at home, and continue in our service with a message by Kevin Acoin this morning. So let me speak this call to worship over you. Welcome, friends, to this holy day. We come to offer thanks. We come to sing and pray. Welcome, friends, to this time set apart. A time to remember those we love. A time to remember the holy promises of God. Welcome, friends, to this table of remembrance and joy. The table where we are fed. The feast we share with many. Welcome, friends, and let us worship our God together.
Our deliverer, you Well, hello, friends. I am here at our ministry center, sitting on this red couch, and that means that I get to introduce to you, yes, another person, a guest speaker, while I'm on my medical leave. And I want to introduce you to Kevin Acoin. Kevin and his wife, Brianne, I've known for years, had the privilege of officiating their wedding. Kevin was part of my youth ministry years ago, almost 20 years ago, where he became a Christian and just continued to develop his gifts in ministry and his love for Jesus and love for the church. Kevin is currently working at Acts Seminary on the Trinity Western campus, as well as not only working full-time, but he is also finishing up his degree, his doctoral degree in his Doctor of Ministry. And so we are thankful to have him. I will endorse him and look forward to what we can learn from Kevin today as he faithfully brings the word today. And blessed are the merciful. So, peace to you.
Hello, everyone. My name is Kevin Acoin. My family and I are a part of Jericho Ridge Community Church in Surrey. And from week to week, I serve as the Assistant Director of Admissions at ACT Seminaries at Trinity Western University. Every week, I get to have conversations with people who are considering the possible role of theological education in their lives and how it could help them live out the good news of Jesus with more thoughtfulness and conviction. Meeting new people and helping them discover what God might have for their future is something I enjoy immensely. Today, in our continuing series focusing on Jesus' series of pithy sayings referred to as the Beatitudes, we're looking at mercy. Jesus simply says, "God blesses those who are merciful, for they will be shown mercy." I have to admit that I initially had a hard time with this one. On the surface, mercy actually seems like a simple, straightforward idea. So then I asked myself, what could I say about it that would be fresh and helpful? But reflecting more deeply and more closely on mercy has taken me on a deeper journey. One of the moments in my own life that captures most clearly for me both the power and the messiness of mercy is an interaction that I had with my dad. I was 23 at the time. I had not actually seen my dad for about 10 years, hadn't talked to him. After my parents divorced when I was 8, we had some years of inconsistent interaction, but then it just stopped. All those years later, I received a birthday card from him. I was really surprised. And as it happened, I had recently begun a quest to understand myself better through some counseling that I was doing. And a lot of issues had come up that were related to my father not being around, and I needed to clear those up, so this seemed like it came at the right time. So I made the decision to meet him, wondering what relationship there might be, if any, left between us. When we met, it was really awkward, as you might imagine. He tried to make small talk for a little bit, but I hadn't come for that, so I steered the conversation toward what I really wanted to hear and say. First, I wanted to know why he had stopped seeing his kids and what had happened to him since I'd seen him last. As it turned out, he'd been taking hard drugs for a long time, even back when I was young. In fact, he had a pattern of using various drugs on and off even since his teens. And his escalating drug use was in large part why my parents split and why he eventually broke off contact. I didn't know any of this. I wouldn't even have guessed it. It never came through in his interaction with me growing up. And in that moment, I saw, in a completely new light, the man that I thought I had known. His flaws somehow felt different. His self-absorption in his own pain and habit meant that he couldn't have cared for those people around him. But whatever the reason for his behavior, it was important for me to tell him the ways that his action and his absence had hurt me and how I was still trying to process what happened. But in my mind, the most important reason I decided to meet with him was that I wanted him to know that because of the forgiveness that I had received from Christ 5 or 6 years before, because of that forgiveness, I wholeheartedly wanted to extend that same forgiveness to him. I told him I wasn't angry anymore, that I no longer held his actions against him. That, to me, was mercy. So what is mercy exactly? And why is it something that Jesus in particular seems to bless in the Beatitudes? Thinking carefully about this question is going to give us a much better idea of what mercy can actually look like and what being merciful may demand of us. My initial cynical take on Jesus' statement is actually that extending mercy is a way for people to get what they want and deserve. I mean, if any of us wants to receive God's mercy, and who doesn't, then the best way to guarantee that we receive that mercy, according to what Jesus says, is somehow that we show mercy to other people and hope God is merciful to us. So in this scenario, mercy becomes inauthentic, half-hearted, transactional at best. Or there could actually even be a darker side. We could hear Jesus' words here as an ultimatum or even a threat. This theory especially makes sense in light of what Jesus says later within the same Sermon on the Mount as sort of an appendix to the Lord's Prayer. If you forgive those who sin against you, your Father, your Heavenly Father will forgive you. But if you refuse to forgive others, your Father will not forgive your sins. And in my mind, mercy and forgiveness are so intricately linked that it feels like Jesus' praise of mercy in the Beatitudes is somehow like a veiled threat to withhold God's mercy as a way of manipulating his audience into behaving properly. But that, to me, in no way squares with the Jesus who blesses those who mourn and those who are poor. It seems clear to me that mercy expressed from a place of fear or desire to impress God or earn something, that wouldn't really be mercy anymore at all. So what's the other view? There are three equally important components to genuine mercy, I think. First, it always starts with a situation and a story. There's some kind of conflict, disappointment, or frustration. Maybe someone has been oppressed or wounded by someone else, or perhaps they've made some choices that have now resulted in negative consequences for themselves and others. My dad had some painful experiences with his own dad in his early days, and it allowed him to make some serious choices that had hurt himself and other people. They're painful circumstances that call out for hope. Mercy is always a relevant and a timely response to the situations that people find themselves in. Second, mercy is rooted in compassion. Once any of us encounter a person in such a situation, it's an experience of compassion that allows us to extend mercy. To feel compassion is to feel within ourselves the weight of what the other person is experiencing in a visceral, gut-level kind of way. We're moved by the suffering of others. And in that moment with my dad, he no longer was someone who I had assumed had maliciously wounded me, but someone who had himself been wounded and struggled then to live well. Finally, mercy is an act. It doesn't end at a feeling of compassion. An experience of compassion is the seed that can sprout into an act of mercy. It's a generous act toward the other. In the Bible, a version of this word refers to acts of charity and also alms. To be merciful is to respond with concrete action. Throughout his ministry, Jesus encountered sick and isolated people who asked for his mercy. And in response, he felt the compassion, and that caused him to draw near to them and respond to them in their time of need. And he touched the lepers in order to heal them physically and allow them to reintegrate back into their family and social networks. In Jesus' story about a Good Samaritan in the book of Luke, chapter 10, he tells about a man who helped another who had been beaten by robbers and left by the side of the road to die. And Jesus labels the Good Samaritan's actions toward this man as merciful. And my response of mercy to my dad was to extend words of forgiveness and give him another chance at relationship. And these three factors come together as authentic mercy, which is a compassionate, concrete response to another person that seeks to address their suffering. The foundation and fountain of authentic mercy is God. Mercy is part of God's character throughout the whole sweep of Scripture. It's one of God's fundamental attributes. God is the originator of mercy. Mercy from God is rooted in God's faithfulness to the special and enduring promise that God made with God's people. Promises that God intends to keep and act on despite the fact that God's people, the church, has as often as not departed from God's ways and wounded God's heart. So this is where things get way more challenging. God models for God's people what it means to be merciful, especially in those situations where compassion is challenging because the other person doesn't deserve our mercy. It was through no fault of his own that the man whom the Good Samaritan helped was injured, but what happens when someone makes bad choices and reaps the consequences of those actions? In my experience, it's harder to feel compassion for someone who has harmed themselves. Or, even more challenging yet, is when someone does something that harms us, either indirectly or worse, directly, and maybe on purpose. Suddenly, it's not so easy to feel compassion or believe that that person deserves any mercy from us. Furthermore, God's example of mercy to God's people models an example of what it means to be merciful in relationship. Again, the Good Samaritan did not know the man whom he helped. He chose to do the right thing, and it cost him time and inconvenience, but he had no relational skin in the game. More challenging are situations that call for mercy when there's a nuanced dance in relationship of history, expectation, assumption, and pain. To show mercy is to be vulnerable to the other person, but they may have wounded us. We fear we might be wounded again. Maybe we even desire to return the wound by expressing our anger or withholding our affection and forgiveness. Yet, if you are a follower of Jesus, the one who called you from darkness into light and planted the seed of the Spirit in you, invites you through that same Spirit to answer yes to the call to follow in the way of Christ and the Father through acts of selfless mercy. Throughout this Beatitude series, we've been speaking very clearly about an interpretation of the Beatitudes as a blessing, a state, rather than a behavior. The Beatitudes are not just some moralistic discourse that features good actions and attitudes for God's people to adopt in order to receive God's blessing. Rather, they're good news, a good news proclamation that God's blessings exist for God's people right now where they are as they encounter tough circumstances that may well make them doubt God's blessing. Now, that makes sense in the case of those who are poor, or those who mourn, or who've been humbled by the ups and downs of life. It makes sense for those people who are hungering and thirsting for righteousness because it likely means that they've been victims of injustice, and so they passionately yearn for something to be different. When it comes to mercy, I'm somewhat confused, to be honest. As I have suggested in what I've said so far, mercy seems to be more like a character trait, more like a choice than any particular state someone finds themselves in, whether they like it or not. Is it possible that what Jesus has in mind is that the merciful find themselves in a situation where the opportunity to be merciful is kind of foisted upon them? Perhaps the merciful ones Jesus has in mind are those who are wounded and then backed into a corner and forced to make a hard choice. In such situations, it seems to me there are three choices that we can make: to extend mercy, to withhold mercy and instead nurture resentment, or to ignore the situation completely and choose apathy that doesn't see the offender as even worthy of compassion, let alone mercy. In other words, we're either moved by and respond to others, or we steel our hearts against the suffering of others, or our eyes are even blind to see others in their suffering. Mercy is not something that I imagine most people would freely choose, because it's costly, it's messy, it's awkward. But it is the most Christ-like response to an unwanted situation, more often than not. And Jesus says that those who are forced into a space where they need to recognize the supremacy of mercy, in that very situation, they are blessed. I'll admit that I don't so far have a really coherent way of thinking about mercy. Jesus seems to call us to go out of our way to be merciful to people far and near, and we can respond to that call through the power of the Spirit. But any of us who found ourselves in a situation that's much more personal and emotional, and when we find ourselves in that kind of situation where it's we have to make a hard decision about how to react, we can find comfort in Jesus' words about the blessings attached to mercy. So can both of these be true at the same time? I have to say yes. These aphorisms of Jesus in the Beatitudes are signs of the kingdom, and they give God's people a vision of the good world that God wants to build. The Beatitudes can become clues of what to look for in the world. But if we really want to feel the power of these, we can't keep our eyes fixed on the words on the page. And this is where we can lean on others to help us see the reality of the Beatitudes in daily life. Jesus reminds us that blessedness is already out there, that the way God's Spirit is already at work is often quiet, unassuming, but revolutionary. Mercy may be hard to see, but it is earth-shakingly powerful. It seems to me that mercy actually purposely doesn't call attention to its work or the one who's dispensing the mercy. Mercy covers over sin rather than demanding a public account for it. And even if mercy is exercised with the hope of receiving God's mercy, God may just as often be the only one who even knows and sees anyway, outside of the person to whom a follower of Jesus has decided to show mercy. Indeed, mercy and the Beatitudes in general fly under the radar because they're countercultural. As Stanley Hauerwas writes, Jesus simply announces the great surprise that these people who are not significant or honored in their society are precisely the ones who have received the honor to be first among those called into the God's kingdom. To see mercy in action in the world does not only inspire us to do the same, but it's actually evidence that God is at work in the world, particularly in and among the community of Jesus followers. The Beatitudes are a summons to live in the present in a way that will make sense in God's promised future, because that future has arrived in the present in Jesus of Nazareth. It may seem upside down, but we're called to believe with great daring that it is, in fact, the right way up. Try it and see. So says N.T. Wright in Matthew for Everyone. It may be the right way, but it's messy. It's messy and it's costly. What I didn't say in the story at the beginning was that my dad, he's not a very spiritual man or religious. He didn't even really have a category in his mind that would help him understand what I had to offer. He didn't really understand forgiveness. He didn't really understand mercy. He didn't understand the God of the universe who had come to me and beckoned me to be merciful. All I got was a blank stare. He didn't even fully own his actions against me. And you know what? I haven't heard from him since. And I don't expect I probably ever will, although he only lives about an hour away. Mercy is messy. It doesn't make sense. It doesn't pay off. But to those who display it, however they display it, and whether they seek it out or whether it comes to them, these are people whom our God is already blessing with a vision of the good work that he's bringing to completion even now in this present moment in the life of the church and the life of the world. So church, let's keep ourselves open to God's desire for mercy in us and to us, and let's keep ourselves open to how God is working it out in the world every day around us through his Spirit.
Thank you, Kevin, for that beautiful message. Friends, would you take out your elements now as we engage in communion together? So we come to the Lord's Supper together as children of our one God. Jesus makes the guest list, not us. You are all invited. Our family, chosen by God, is gathered from west to east, even the lowest and the least. Jesus, when he was resurrected from the dead, revealed himself to his disciples in the breaking of bread around a table. May we see the face of God today as we come to the Lord's Supper. On the night he was handed over, the night before he was crucified, Jesus gathered with his friends for a meal. He took the bread and after blessing it, he broke it, saying, "This is my body, which is broken for you. As often as you eat, remember me." Please pray with me. Jesus, as we take this bread, let it be a sign of all you did for us and who you are for us. Thank you for this bread of life. You may eat the bread. After sharing the bread, Jesus took a cup of wine and gave it to them to drink, saying, "This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you." Let's pray. Jesus, as we drink this cup, let it be a sign for all you did for us and who you are for us. Thank you that you bring us peace that passes understanding. You may drink. Let me pray, friends. Jesus, through your death and resurrection, you reconciled the world to God. And through your example, you have shown us a way to peace. Give us strength as the people of God to be channels of peace in the world, speaking your peace, living your peace, and always longing for that moment of eternal peace when we shall see you again. Amen. Let's sing as we respond to this, my friends.
Lost or saved, find their way at the sound of your great name. All condemned.
Coast Hills. Go in peace. Go in love. Take what you find here back with you out into the world. Share with it those you meet along the way, and then come back next Sunday. We will be here waiting for you. Blessings on your week.
I'm living proof of what the mercy of God can do. If you knew me then, you'd believe me now. He turned my whole life upside down. Took the old and he made it. That's just what the mercy of God can do. Now I'm alive to tell the story, how I've overcome. It's His goodness and mercy and the power of His blood. I'm so glad that my freedom wasn't based on what I've done, but the goodness and mercy and the power of the blood. So much power in the blood. The things I've said, the choices made that I regret. Oh, I would still be lost. Oh, but for the mercy of God. Now I'm alive to tell the story, how I've overcome. It's His goodness and mercy and the power of the blood. I'm so glad that my freedom wasn't based on what I've done, but the goodness and mercy and the power of the blood. Mercy of God.
arms and the power of the blood. The power of the blood. There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Still heals today.
Nothing but his blood, nothing.